Professor, we'll start in another 3 minutes, if that's fine.
Yeah, that's perfectly fine with me. And it's for 15 minutes, correct?
Yes, 15 minutes. If you want, you can take a few questions we'll be getting from the audience. That's up to you.
Yeah, we'll see how it goes.
Sure, not a problem.
Jay, what is the name of your colleague?
Rajiv.
Rajiv Roy.
Yeah.
I was just okay. Thank you.
Sure.
You know, I'm glad we decided to log in a few minutes early. I was having difficulty logging in because I was using the link for the dry test that we had the other day. And that good. It's all good.
It's good. It's always good to join earlier, you know. I mean, yeah. So we're good to go all the time. So I think, just let me have a word with the IT team.
Is there a way for me to see some of the summit or not really?
We'll share a link with you for tomorrow because today the summit concludes with your session. And okay. Then you can perhaps have a look. That's the Hive link, which is the software skin that we use.
Just a snippet. Anyway, okay.
Sure. Ladies and gentlemen, I am really privileged to have with us Professor Ajay Kohli here today. His keynote address is on, you know, is themed from product-centric to customer-centric journeys. As you all know, Professor Kohli is the Gary T. and Elizabeth R. Jones Chair and Professor of Marketing, the Scheller College of Business, Georgia Institute of Technology. You know, he has previously also taught at Emory University, Harvard Business School, the University of Texas, at Austin, and at several prestigious universities in Europe and Asia. His research focuses on customer centricity, end-to-end customer solutions, sales management, and B2B marketing. He's also among the 100 most cited authors in the field of business and economics combined in a decade, and two of his articles are among the 10 most cited Journal of Marketing articles in a quarter century. He has also received several career contribution awards, including the prestigious Paul D. Converse Award and the AMA McGraw-Hill Irwin Award. Without further ado, may I present to you, ladies and gentlemen, Professor Ajay Kohli.
Thank you very much, Jay. Welcome to our session. It's really a pleasure for me to have this opportunity to share some thoughts with you. I am, you know, when I was growing up in India, I used to see all sorts of announcements from CII, and I held them in very high esteem. And little did I know that I'll have an opportunity to share some thoughts with you on this forum. And I thank Rajiv and Jay for the opportunity to make that come about. So let me sort of give you the main point that I want to share with you, that I want to talk about today. The main idea that I'd like to sort of share with you is that when we think about customer journeys from a product standpoint, we sort of do a good job. But when we think about customer journeys from customers' perspectives, then what happens is a lot more players come into the picture. And we need to worry about focusing and coordinating those additional players in addition to ourselves if we want to deliver great customer experiences. So that's the main idea that I'd like to share with you. And I'd like to try to bring this to life using a couple of examples. They are actually from the US, but they'll be very familiar to you. And then I'd like to conclude with a little bit more elaboration on the main idea that if we want to deliver great customer experiences, we need to look at customer journeys from their perspective, not from the perspective of our products and how customers interface with them. So that's the main sort of idea. So if you want to think about a product-centric customer journey, this is kind of what we generally think about. So, you know, customers recognize the need for our product. They look for information about our products from various sources. They evaluate the various options that they have and purchase it. And then they use our product. And then they sort of, you know, talk about it. And they are happy or unhappy and post reviews and so forth. So the kinds of things that we sort of look at is what triggers the need to buy our service. So take an airline example. You know, what triggers the need to fly? Could be a business-related reason, could be personal reason, whatever. Then they search for information. They might go on the website. They might talk to their travel agent and whatnot. So they look at that. That's part of the experience. Then they sort of evaluate the information that they receive. They sort of trade off cost for convenience and whatnot. Then they place the orders, and then they actually learn what kind of services are available. And then they consume the travel, meaning they fly from one city to another city. And then after that, they post some ratings on satisfaction. They talk about their experiences with other customers. They write reviews, and they decide whether they're going to fly my airline again or not, or pick another airline. So that's, notice over here, what's happened is we are talking about the customer's experience vis-a-vis our product, our airline, and that's what we are focused on, and which is all well and good, and that's very important. But what happens is when you think about customer journeys from the customer's perspectives, which I call customer-centric perspective, a slightly different and a more complete picture comes to the fore. So when you want to think about the same airline from a customer-centric standpoint, you can chop up the journey into three parts. There's the pre-flight experience, there's the in-flight experience, and then there's the post-flight experience. So if you think about the pre-flight experience, it comprises a bunch of things. You kind of search online, you talk with a travel agent, you perhaps buy a ticket from a travel agent, physical travel agent, the customer prints the boarding passes, then they drive to the airport, they check in at the counter, drop off their bags, they go through security, and then they wait at the sort of gate area. They look around at shops near the gate area. They might eat at some place, and then eventually they line up in a queue and board the plane. So that's sort of the pre-flight experience. And then comes the in-flight experience, and this comprises a bunch of things as well. So they enter the aircraft, they put their bags, you know, up in the cabins, they take their seat, they listen to announcements, sometimes pretty nasty, loud, or unclear. The plane takes off, cruises. You might watch a movie, have a meal, use the restroom, land, pull down your bags, and then deplane. So that's sort of the in-flight experience, if you will. And then there's the post-flight experience, which is if you're traveling internationally, you clear customs, you clear passport control, you pick up your bags, you take a taxi or a train, check into a hotel, call home saying I've arrived safely, or text home, get a receipt. You submit the receipt for reimbursement if it happens to be a business trip. So notice over here, a couple of things. The stuff marked in stars, so this stuff over here, passport control, collection of baggage, taking a train, hotel, whatnot, and the stuff over here, travel agent from whom you buy a ticket, driving to the airport, going through security, the great area, all these things, the airline has very little direct control over these experiences. And so if I want to deliver a great customer experience from a customer standpoint, I have to worry about not just my services, which are sort of mostly bunched up over here, but I also have to worry about customer experiences before they take the flight and after they take the flight. So that becomes the goal. And you might ask, well, what the heck can I do about customs? I don't control them. What can I do about passport control? I don't control them. The baggage thing is the airport's thing. I don't control that. The drive to the airport, I don't control that. I'm an airline, for Pete's sake. I offer services. And fact of the matter is, a number of companies are actually doing this. So for example, talk about the gate area or shopping and so forth over here. Delta Airlines over the past few years has invested $2 billion, literally $2 billion with a B, dollars, constructing its own terminal at LA and New York Airport. And the whole idea there really is, if you're flying Delta, you will have a great experience because we have a dedicated terminal. It's designed beautifully, and it is going to be a much better experience than if you travel a different airline. And that's going to give us more business, or we're going to charge higher prices for it, or what have you. Singapore Airlines, another example. Again, airline. These people have coordinated with customs and passport control and baggage control and so forth at Changi Airport. Many of you may have been there. They have coordinated their operations such that they have a benchmark, like from the time you land, your plane lands at the gate or comes in at the gate to the time you're in a taxi or some other vehicle, it'll be no more than 20 minutes flat out. So you clear the customs, clear passport control, pick up your bags, you're out on this curb and ready to get into a taxi, no more than 20 minutes. So if you can offer that kind of experience, then that gives you a huge competitive advantage. Let me sort of give you one more example. This is an example about purchasing cars. And I'm going to talk about USAA, which, as many of you may know, is an organization that provides financial services to armed forces, servicemen and servicewomen. And let's take a look. So basically, they're in the banking business and insurance business as far as car purchase is concerned. And if you think about the journey from a customer standpoint, this is what the customer has to do. They first do some research on cars. Then they sort of narrow down their choices. Customers narrow down their choices to a few, one or two. Then they sort of get a pre-approval. They have to go to a bank number one, bank number two, bank number three, and finally find a good rate for the loan, and finally get a pre-approval for the loan from one of the banks. And then comes the fun part, which is the most painful part. The customer has to go from one dealer to another car dealer of the same manufacturer and kind of negotiate the heck out of those car salespeople. And that's probably one of the least desired experiences that customers have. Then you go back to the loan from whom you obtained the pre-approval and finalize that loan. And then you start hunting for insurance, you shop for insurance, and finally buy the insurance. So now here comes USAA. It is in the business of offering loans and insurance. And that's what it does. So this stuff that you see in the black, that's none of their business. They are in the business of the stuff in green. And the car dealers, that's not their problem. But what has USAA done? It's quite remarkable, actually. So USAA offers now car buying services to its members. And all you got to do if you're a USAA member is go to their website shown right over here. Once you go there, you have access to a whole bunch of different cars, makes and models. And you can sort of configure your what options you want or don't want right there on the website. So if you want leather seats, well, plug that in. If you want a fancy steering wheel, plug that in and just basically put in what you want. And then comes the fun part. Then a USAA has negotiated prices with a bunch of dealers. And so what it's going to tell you is, what is the average price of that car if you were to purchase from USAA? So all the negotiation, the painful part, that's already done for you. And since you bank with them, they know your financial situation, how much loan you qualify for or don't qualify for, all that stuff is already pre-done. Then what happens? You basically sign in, and lo and behold, they tell you who are the dealers in your neighborhood that have the car and what prices, what price you can get your preferred car for. And then they give you a comparison, what you're going to be paying and what non-members pay. And then they sort of have this beautiful chart where they tell you whether you're skewed, whether it's a great price or a terrible price or just a pretty good price, not only nationally, but in your neighborhood, in your locality. And they will also tell you whether the prices for a real car available right now, or do you have to wait? All that stuff is already done. The insurance part, they already take care of. The loan is already taken care of. All you got to do is click on buy, purchase the car, and drive away. So notice over here is a financial services company, USAA. It is negotiating with dealers. It is taking all of the hassle out of the picture just so that you have a great personal great experience. So the main thing I'd like to sort of leave you with in the minute or so that we have is basically, if you think about customer journeys from customer standpoint, there are three experiences, and these experiences are influenced not just by the firm, but also by various partners or other companies, and how well the customer knows how to use your product or service. That's important. So we have to work on our partners, other companies, and the customers themselves. And as we know, customer satisfaction is not just a function of how well I perform or we perform, but also a function of their expectations. And who sets their expectations? Well, those expectations come from what we have to say. They come from what partners promise our customers. They come from social media. People are voicing complaints, and they come from competitors who keep raising the bar on the level of experiences desired. So in a nutshell, if I had to sort of leave you with one thought, it is approach customer journeys from their perspective, not from your product's perspective. And what that will reveal to you is that there are many other players who are involved in delivering customer satisfaction. And our job is to manage and collaborate with those players in order to deliver a great experience. So I'm 1 minute over time, so let me stop there. Thank you very much for your patience, and I hope that this was of some interest to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Kohli. That was really fantastic as a session. We do have a few questions. I leave it to you in case you would like to take even one of them.
Sure, let's take one or two, yeah.
Okay. So I think the first one is a bit technical, but I'll put it to you anyway. You know, while many businesses are trying to put the customer and his journey in the heart of the multi-channel marketing and CRM ecosystem, the borders between channels are blurring, fueled by mobile devices and other technologies. How do marketers deal with channel-agnostic consumers and create a unifying buying journey?
That's a great question, actually. Fundamentally, it boils down to two things. One is has to do simply with information sharing, meaning one channel needs to be aware of what the other channel is doing, and not just in general, but with regard to a given customer. So if I'm a customer, whether I deal with Delta Airlines directly or through Expedia or booking.com or whatever, I don't care. Each one of them needs to know who I am, what my experience has been, what I have purchased or not purchased, and all of that stuff. So one is information sharing at a very specific level at the individual customer level. And number two, we've got to provide some sort of incentives or encouragement or self-interest of some sort so that the goals of the different channels are aligned towards serving the customer rather than maximizing their individual level profitability or revenues or whatever. And that means you have to make customer satisfaction a big portion of how you compensate and motivate individual channels, if you will. So coordination of that becomes very important. So two things: one, information sharing across the channels, and number two, incentivizing or encouraging somehow a focus on the ultimate goal, which is customer experience delivery.
Professor, one last question. I have many, but I think I can pick one.
Sure.
Yeah. So, this is coming from probably a retail chain. So the question goes, for retail businesses built on physical foundations and migrating to digital spaces, how can managers stop viewing each channel in a silo and instead integrate them into a larger unified strategy. So I think you've spoken a bit about this, but if you could contextualize it with retail, yeah.
So that's again a very nice question, very very interesting question. We don't have a heck of a lot of time to go into this, but you can think of these channels really as complementary channels. So it's not as if, the retail is competing with the online and so forth. And especially now, the online thing is becoming more like retail with virtual reality, augmented reality, and other digital technologies that are increasingly giving consumers they're approaching the kind of experience that customers have inside physical stores. So we were still a ways away from that happening. People are working on developing technology where you can smell a product sitting in your home and that kind of stuff, but we're still a ways away from that. But basically, you can think of these two channels as having distinct capabilities, especially when it comes to sensory kinds of things. You really can't beat physical retail stores. That is really, really valuable. And no matter what, we're still quite far away from digital technologies emulating those. But fundamentally, back to the question, you can think of these two channels as having complementary attributes. And the trick becomes, how do you figure out how to marry the complementarities together such that a consumer or customer has a fantastic experience? So let me just leave it at that. I was going to talk about showrooming and people going to physical stores and buying online and that kind of stuff. But let me just leave it there in the interest of time.
Professor, thank you very much, for time. In fact, you've given us more than, you would have. And the questions, though we have many of them, perhaps we could have you later with us at another physical intervention in the future. And please take care. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. And all the best and good luck. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Yeah. Bye.